for this morning comes from the book of Acts. We're going to read Acts chapter 3. Not all of it. We're going to read the first 10 verses. Acts chapter 3. One day Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer at 3 in the afternoon. Now a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked at him as did John, then Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from him. Then Peter said, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I do have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what happened to him. This is reading God's Word. I noticed something, a little bonus sermon out of this little message. The fact that this temple gate was called Beautiful is significant because some people call it the Golden Gate now, and it was sealed up after Jesus entered Jerusalem. And the theory is that it won't be opened again until Jesus returns. And we read about a man who has new life and enters the temple praising God and victorious. I just thought that was an interesting little side note. That's not my sermon, though, for today, but it's one of those things that God gives you when you read a second time. It pops in your head. But we're talking about God's beauty and faith in Him and rest in Him. And if you ever need a place to get away, to handle the crazies of life, I found it. In fact, I'm next in line. Does anybody recognize that? That is the Traverse City State Mental Asylum. It's now called the Commons. High-end condos in there and restaurants and businesses. But it was Traverse City State Hospital or the Northern Michigan Insane Asylum, which I hear a lot of people call it. I think people call it that because they think it sounds more haunted. I don't know. There was no ghosts in there when I saw it. It was very easy to get in back in the day when Dr. James Munson first opened it in 1885 as the first supervisor. All you needed was to display some of the mental maladies or physical maladies at the time, and you needed two doctors to sign off on it. In fact, they said that a husband back then could have his wife committed just because she was having a crappy day. Mm-hmm. And all they needed was two doctors. I think Rhonda is going to try to see if it'll work on me. And that's fine, because I need another retreat. I'd love to live in these condos here. It'd be great. Sign me up. But according to the tour that we took a couple weekends ago, it opened with 43 patients. And what I found really interesting is that unlike other institutions at the time that were just dumping grounds for the unwanted or the uncontrollable or the undiagnosable, the Traverse City State Hospital was built specifically and run differently. It was run, like I said, by Dr. James Munson, who ran it first and was an advocate of the beauty is therapy method. It's so important that Ron even bought the t-shirt when This beauty is therapy method is a Quaker method of care. It was invented by a gentleman named Dr. Thomas Kirkbride, and unusual to the time, then he wanted to treat the patients as people. He advocated for this moral treatment of patients throughout the USA, treating the person instead of the problem, treating the person like a person. Not just a patient. Thomas Kirkbride literally wrote the book on this system of care. It's called On the Construction, Organization, and General Arrangements of Hospitals for the Insane. Doesn't sound like a very interesting book, but what's interesting is it is actually a construction manual for not only how to run a hospital like this, but how to build the buildings. And it's all based on this idea that even though it's a state hospital, it's going to show a beauty on the outside as well as the beauty on the inside. And that was hard to fathom at the time with insane asylums and these state hospitals. But like I said, even the buildings were built in such a way, they had rich wood cabinetry, they had marble floors, they calming colors on the walls, all for the best moral treatment of the patients. The whole complex was built in a direction that no matter which way the wind blew, they could open up all the windows and get fresh air in for people. And Kirkbride said every patient gets their own window. We're not going to lock the outside from these people. We're going to let them understand that they're still part of the world. I don't think they had the balconies on them at the time. This picture does, but you can't really see it very well. But in the windows and where they have the where they have the mullions, they actually put bars in the windows to keep them safe, but they built the windows in such a way where the bars were hidden so that they couldn't tell that they were locked in for their own safety. Each floor, from the lightest cases of mental issues to the darkest cases of insanity, they all had their own large great room with 13 foot tall ceilings and fine furniture to sit on, and like I said, all the windows could be open and there was sunlight pouring in, and it was all for the best mental treatment of the patient, and it even helped the people that worked there as well. Patients were encouraged to, if they were an artist, to hang artwork on the wall and paint on the wall. In fact, there was an article I was reading while we were waiting in line that there was a pretty famous patient who never put his artwork on canvas. He just took to himself to paint the walls. And when they were doing some reconstruction and tearing some old plaster down, they found some of this guy, and he signed them, but would paint on the bricks. And as they were doing this reconstruction, they found some of his old paintings. But they were encouraged to do this. They were encouraged to help flood this building and this the treatments and these patients with this beauty all around them. Like I said, beauty is therapy, they would say. Our tour guide made an interesting comment on that tour that no one ever tried to escape because nobody ever wanted to. They were treated so nicely. They never had a problem with people breaking out. Apparently they did have a problem with wanderers. There was no fences, there were no locks on the doors, so at times patients would get out and end up in the adjoining neighborhoods, and they would just call the hospital and they would come get them and very nicely walk them back in. It wasn't ever really an emergency. This humane treatment, this idea of bringing beauty into these patients' lives that would normally not have beauty had they not been brought to a Kirkbride institution, helped a lot of these people to complete their treatment, actually, and be released back to their families if their families were able to care for them. During the whole time of this tour and listening to how people are humanely and morally treated, I just couldn't help but say that this treatment was based on the love of Jesus Christ. You could tell that just by, even though it's not a religious institution, that there was this feeling of love and this beauty of Jesus Christ weaved in everything they did. In the New Testament, we can read a lot of different accounts of Jesus and the apostles going about and treating all sorts of physical and mental conditions. We remember the person who lived among the graves, who was demon-possessed, and we hear about our gentleman friend today who couldn't walk and when they were walking on this earth, though, there was really many diagnoses of what people had, but there was always one cause, it seemed, and that was sin. Jesus often answered the question, what did this person's parents do to cause them to be this way? And many times the cure for the sick at that time was just to put them out of the way, out of sight, out of mind. We hear of leper colonies, people who are unclean are supposed to stay out of society. The person that Peter and John encountered in our reading this morning, you know, he was kind of set out of the way. He needed to make some money, but we'll put him out of the way so he can still beg. This man was a person unable to walk since birth, minimized in life to become a beggar. This man could have had anything from arthritis in his feet and ankles and knees, to polio, to cerebral palsy, to a incomplete construction of the spinal cord and system. But what we know for sure, and this book was mainly written by Luke, a doctor, was that he was just lame. And so we'll go with lame, we'll just a man kind of stuck, not able to go anywhere, relying on other people. We can't be sure of what this type of theology, what type of religion this guy had. You know, we know from the rest of the story that he was a child of God because he was healed and he began to praise God. But he must have known that the temple was an important place to go. So he would sit and beg there and perhaps play on the religion and the charitable feelings of people coming out of church, coming out of prayer. But what was important, I see, and we can read in this story, is that Peter and John, with everything that they were going through, starting the new church, finding new apostles, dealing with things, persecution, that Peter and John noticed this man on their way to prayer. They recognized a beauty in this person. They noticed it so much that they stopped. They spoke to him. They treated him kindly. And they even healed him. There's a lot of beauty in the beginning of this story and Peter's actions, because a person with a disability back then wasn't looked at as a beautiful person. But there this maybe not so beautiful person was sitting at the beautiful gate every morning, every day. This beautiful gate, they say that in its time, it was a double-gated, double-tunneled passageway into the temple, and it was ordained, this ornate ceilings with gold and marble, and it had brass gates on it. And so this lame person sitting by this beautiful gate, just waiting for somebody to come by and have compassion on him. And I'm certain that at the time, Peter and John had spotted many people begging on the way to the temple. Jerusalem was probably full of many poor people begging for money. And it probably wasn't a new thing, but like I said, for some reason, Peter and John recognized their hearts were drawn to this person at the beautiful gate. They were filled with the Holy Spirit to recognize this. They were given this ability by Jesus to heal and to raise the dead. And they had the love of Jesus in their hearts. And so they were very confident in knowing what they were going to do. When this man asked them for money, what does Peter say? No, look at us. Look at us. Look at me. Very confident. And he knew what he was about to do. And he tells this beggar, Peter says, I don't have what you think you need. I don't have any money. I don't have any silver or gold. But what I do have, I know you need, and I'm going to give it to you. Peter had the blessing of Jesus Christ to heal and to help people. And so that's what Peter did. He gave him his hand and helped him up by his right hand. He says, in the name of Jesus Christ, stand up and walk. Now, a lot of things can be said about the fact that this guy's life changed. Well, sure, he didn't have to be a beggar anymore because he could walk, he could get a job, he could he could go back to normal life, and I'm sure that was it, but just this simple fact that Peter and John had their radar on, if you will, for somebody who needed the love of Jesus, and the fact that they could notice him in a town full and all these people going in and out of the temple, they say the steps to the beautiful gate were 210 feet long. I didn't think about how big that is, but to be able to see a beggar 210 feet away. Most people would see these beggars and then, you know, they would walk around them because it's uncomfortable to go by a person like that. But they had the radar on, they had their senses on. That's such a beautiful thing. And the timing of all of it was beautiful because the Holy Spirit was alive and well. They had been given the gift of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, and they were empowered by Jesus Christ, and they had this passion and this willingness to spread the good news of the gospel. It was no mistake. The time was right for the love of Jesus to be shared again to the world outside the church. And Peter and John, because they had the teachings of Jesus fresh in their mind and fresh in their hearts, knew that everyone was beautiful in their own way. And that everybody was deserving of God's grace through Jesus Christ. So they acted upon it. They went over to this gentleman. They talked to him. They didn't give him money. They gave him a renewed life. We live in an ugly world, right? I mean, God's creation is beautiful, and you know the sun is great out there, and we have a cool breeze and things like that, but because of the fact we live in a broken creation, because of sin, has made this planet ugly. We hear about people shouting at each other, shooting at each other, friends and families who at one time that really loved each other and showed the love of Jesus Christ to each other, don't talk anymore. People sitting around complaining about the problems instead of working on solutions together. Problems with race relations in this world have backed down from a boiling point to just a breaking point right now. You know, we've made some progress there, but this world is ugly, and that doesn't even begin to talk about death and disease, how we stop it. And I didn't even mention the unlimited amount of sins in this world that relentlessly try to take us away from our Lord. As Christians in this world, we are called to bring Jesus with us wherever we go.
Amen.
But we can't do it on our own because it's just too big of a task. We need to remind ourselves it's not our job to save everybody, and I know that's some hard truth to hear. But Jesus never promised easy jobs and fun times. Jesus just wanted us to go work on it every day, but he did give us a promise. In Matthew 5, 14 through 16, he says that his followers are a light unto the world. A town on a hill cannot be hidden, neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven.
Yes.
Jesus promised us in this hard time of trying to live in an ugly world that when we have the light of Jesus in us, people will see God. They will understand who God is through the love that we give. What a beautiful thing that is, not only to the people that we meet for the first time, but for us as well. A couple of weeks ago, I stated that it's an honor to love people in the world. And I personally think it's an honor to have people see Jesus in the things that I do and the words that I say, in spite of the fact that I'm a screw-up. And I say that because I sin, but people still see that. The reaction that this lame beggar had is another beautiful part of the story. Not only did he get up and walk, but he jumped to his feet, it says. He jumped to his feet and then he went into the temple praising. and glorifying God with Peter and John, that was probably not something he could ever do because he was lame. Temple laws, temple rules were funny back then. He made this big scene during prayer time in a very positive way. Those in the temple area automatically witnessed this and recognized this was a miracle from God, especially when they realized that the miracle of standing and jumping and talking or walking and praising was this lame beggar that used to sit and beg for change for the people going into the temple. The people suddenly had their eyes open to the complete beauty of this person. They didn't see him as someone that they had to walk around or step over anymore because he was in the way. They saw the beauty of God inside him and recognized him for that. When we recognize the beauty of God and our fellow members of creation, it's because God opens our eyes. God helps us to see. In this ugly world that we live in, we need God to open our eyes to the beauty hiding behind the ugly. Just proves that beautiful things can happen when God opens our eyes.
Amen.
There's something very ugly that our Savior had to experience so that we may personally know the beauty of salvation. Dying on the cross because of and for us was ugly. We don't need to go into how terrible that type of punishment was. But the love of God for his children outshines this ugly. God came down and sacrificed himself for us so that we didn't have to pay that price because we couldn't. We would never be able to. At the Last Supper, Jesus showed his disciples how to remember this sacrifice that he paid for. And today when we share in the communion elements, we will remember as well that we too can celebrate by leaping and jumping and praising God if we need to. We can remember that we can praise his name for this new life we have in Christ because of that ugly thing that Jesus had to go through on the cross for us. As we approach the communion table, let's ask the Lord to prepare us wholly and forgive our sins so that we may all participate in the Lord's Supper together. Shall we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, you have gathered us together as believers in your name. And we gather together now to partake in a little bit of bread and a little bit of juice. And these are signs and symbols that you have blessed us with and given us so that we may remember this sacrifice. Dear Lord, thank you for that sacrifice. Thank you for welcoming us into communion with you, dear Lord. Please wash us free. Wash us clean of sin, dear Heavenly Father. Prepare our hearts for this communion. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. On the night of his arrest, the Lord Jesus took the bread, and after giving thanks to God for it, he broke it. And he said to his disciples, "Take and eat this bread. And remember that this was my body that was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took a cup and poured some wine. He said, "This cup is a new covenant sealed in my blood and shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Every time you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the saving of the earth by the death of the risen Lord Jesus. With thanksgiving, will you join me in prayer to our God? With joy, we praise you, gracious God, for you created heaven and earth, made us in your image and kept covenant with us, even when we fell into sin. We give you thanks for Jesus Christ, our Lord, who by his life and death and resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, we join our voices with all saints and the angels and the whole creation to proclaim the glory of your name. Amen. Congregation, Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord has prepared this table for us, for those who love him and trust in his salvation, all who are truly sorry for their sins, who sincerely believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior and desire to live in obedience to him, are welcome. And to come with gladness to the table of the Lord. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. I'll ask the elders to come up, and we're going to pass both elements out first, and then we will proceed from there. If you wish, in the middle of the communion cup plate, there's the sealed fellowship cups we've been using, if you wish to have one of those. Family of God, this is the body of Christ. Take, eat, and believe, and give thanks to the living God. In this cup of juice, we use it to remember that this was the blood of Christ that poured freely for us for the forgiveness of our sins. Drink it and remember and give thanks to God. Loving God, we thank you that you have fed us in this sacrament. You have united us with Christ Jesus and given us this foretaste of the heavenly banquet in your eternal kingdom. Send us out in the power of your Holy Spirit to live and work and to praise and give glory to your name for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
as we go out from here, go out praising that great and glorious God who is able to do immeasurably more than anything we could think of, anything we could ask for, anything we could understand and wrap our minds around us. Go and bring Him glory in the church and in Christ followers that we are. Go out and bring the love of Jesus to others. Go in peace.